These things are made to do what other trucks shouldn't or can't, and that's what makes them great. They are overbuilt to just a silly level. Everything about them is solid and heavy. So here I am driving this 1974 FJ55 Land Cruiser, or for you Land Cruiser people, an iron pig. Values for a 1974 Land Cruiser FJ55 had rapidly climbed since 2010. 7 years ago, a number one excellent condition FJ55 was commanding prices in the low $30,000 range. But as of early 2021, that same vehicle is valued at $60,000, while a number two good condition FJ55 is valued at $40,300. This video review is intended to give an overview of what it's like to buy an FJ55 Land Cruiser. But keep in mind that values change over time. For even more details and up-to-date information, please go to Hagerty.com. To me, the FJ55 is really the ideal Land Cruiser. It's not the rough and tumble, ubiquitous FJ40 that everybody knows and loves. And it's not the more modern FJ60 wagon. Rather, it's Toyota's first dedicated Land Cruiser wagon. For instance, if you're driving through downtown Milwaukee, with rough and tumble streets, it really soaks up the bumps quite nicely. But smooth in a Land Cruiser is not necessarily smooth in a luxury SUV, so let's not get mistaken there. But these are fun to drive, tough vintage trucks, and sometimes you just want to drive something vintage and tough, and yes, slow. Because this is a 1974, it doesn't really get going all that fast. It does have a lot of torque, it is exceedingly smooth, and it will do just about anything you ask it to do. What you get with an FJ55 is all the good stuff from an FJ40. The tough mechanicals, the rugged solid axle suspension, the great gear whine from the manual transmission that just clicks through the gears, nice solid manual steering, reassuring power brakes, all of that's there. But of course, you also get the practicality I mentioned before, and the fact that you can use this as a vehicle. You can throw the whole family in it and head up to your lake house for the weekend. So this is the FJ55 Land Cruiser. These have been affectionately called the Moose, or more famously, the Iron Pig, because of the way the front end looks. So when you look at the grille and the headlights, you can see it. It also is Toyota's first real station wagon Land Cruiser. The FJ55 was primarily designed to enter the US market and compete with the likes of the Jeep Wagoneer. But really what you want to know is what to look for when you're buying an FJ55. And that is the tricky part. So unfortunately, these things, if exposed to any kind of moisture or inclement weather, practically dissolve themselves in a short period of time. And that's why there aren't a lot of good ones left, and values have been continuously climbing since 2010. Underneath the paint is where you should really be concerned, because again, I hate to say it as a lifelong Land Cruiser guy, but these are notorious rusters. You need to look every inch of an FJ55 over with a microscope. Most vehicles will rust from the bottom up, as we know, but FJ55s also rust from the top down. They rust from this seam here. This drip rail on the roof will start to rust. The roof will rust away first. Then the water gets in and it runs down, and it will rust out the cowl and the inner fenders and the lower fenders. It will rust out the doors and the rocker panels. The wheel arches rust out. In fact, I think it's safe to say the only piece of metal on an FJ55 that won't rust is probably the metal that contains the oil filter media. But even that might rust out if you're not careful. So while there are many shared parts with FJ40 Land Cruisers, such as wheels and hubcaps and turn signal lenses, that kind of thing, many of the parts on the FJ55 are unique to the FJ55 and unavailable in the aftermarket today. Weather strip, trim, some emblems, bumpers. There's a great aftermarket and great parts supply for these vehicles, but trim is one of the things you have a very difficult time finding. looking around the outside of this vehicle, again, we always look for panel gaps. Look how the rocker panels line up. Look at the pinch welds, look for spot welds. Look at everything that would be there when the vehicle left the factory and how it looks today. Now through the FJ55 production run, there were some minor trim differences that came into play. The earlier vehicles have these taillights mounted up high. The tailgate features an electronically operated window glass that raises and lowers either with a key or with a switch on the dashboard. And when it's down, it's very much like being on a screen porch without the screens and with a little less speed. And one of the benefits of having 17 inches more of wheelbase is you have an extended body. So versus an FJ40, the FJ55 really shines with its cargo capacity. You can fit a lot of stuff back here, especially when you fold the rear seat flat. It makes a cargo space almost as big as a Chevy Suburban. So you can't talk about a station wagon without talking about the interior. As far as station wagons go, the FJ55 is about as simple as they get, but it's simple in an awesome way. Now remember, these were a Japanese market car, so you have to picture everything as a right-hand drive vehicle, which is why the radio is offset to the passenger side of the dashboard. Keeping in mind certain odd details like that of a Japanese vehicle adapted for the US market, everything else is very straightforward, as you would expect in a Land Cruiser. It's a 3-speed manual transmission. It's a 2-speed high and low transfer case. If you want heat, you pull a knob over here that says warm. If you want defroster, you reach down and you pull a lever that flips a metal door and puts a little bit of air up to the windshield to defrost it as much as it can. When you go to start it, don't expect one of those luxury American car automatic chokes. You need to pull the choke. If you want your windshield wipers, same thing. One click, that's all you get. There's no intermittent wipers in here. But I'm telling you a bunch of things you probably already know about old utilitarian vehicles and off-roaders. What you really need to know about an FJ55 interior is how original is it. The interiors in these vehicles, with as stout as the powertrain and the chassis are in these things, the interiors are the exact polar opposite. They're basically made out of angel hair and paper mache. This vinyl on the seats, you rarely see an original seat cover in an FJ55 because frankly, it's so thin, if you sit on it with your keys in your back pocket or a cell phone, you'll put a hole in it. The original rubber floor mats, which are not available anymore from Toyota or in the aftermarket, they get brittle and they crack, or people remove them to put carpet in. Dash pads, and a nice original dash pad is unheard of. This one happens to be really nice, but again, low mileage vehicle that didn't get parked out in the sun a lot. Through the end of 1974, the FJ55 featured the F-Series engine, which was 3.9 liters and 125 horsepower. Very high torque, very smooth, very low RPM. In fact, you'll never exceed 3,500 RPM on one of these things just by their basic design. After 1974, the 2F engine entered the picture, which was basically a 4.2 liter updated version of this with 10 more horsepower and a little more torque. The 2F engine was also backed by a 4-speed transmission instead of the 3-speed in the earlier FJ55s. One way to tell from the outside if it's a F engine FJ55 or a 2F engine FJ55 is that the 2F engined FJ55s will have an additional bulge in the hood to clear the larger air cleaner of the 2F engine. Other than a few items that come from not taking care of them the right way, such as not changing the oil or not adjusting the valves on schedule, or overheating them or doing other things that really aren't the car's fault, the F and the 2F engines are virtually indestructible. There was an ad in Period that Toyota put out for the Land Cruiser that said, "We'll know how long a Land Cruiser lasts when the first one wears out." And they weren't kidding. These things can go 200 or 300,000 miles without needing any serious mechanical work. If you take care of your Land Cruiser, it will take care of you. Change the oil, adjust the valves, take the choke off when the engine's starting to warm up. All of these things will ensure that it will give you years and years of reliable service, and you won't have to be on a first name basis with your mechanic. So underneath the FJ55, the same caveats apply. Number one, look for rust. The chassis of these vehicles, just like every other Land Cruiser, very prone to rusting. You want to look at the frame rails, the rocker panels, the body mounts, all the places that there's sheet metal, check it out for rust. Now in this vehicle, for example, it has surface rust on it some mud and dirt. Again, it's an original unrestored truck, but if you poke around it, it's as solid as the day it was built. And that's really what you want to aim for. If you can find an FJ55 that looks like this underneath, I suggest you buy it, because frankly, they don't exist in the wild like this anymore. Most of them have been very rusty or rebuilt with patch panels welded in, that kind of thing. So pay close attention, look at all the areas that you think anywhere water could be trapped, anywhere mud would be trapped, anywhere for trucks from the rust belt, snow, salt, that kind of thing. Other than that, from a mechanical aspect, there's really not much to worry about on a Land Cruiser. They're overbuilt, incredibly rugged machines, solid axle front and rear, leaf springs. It's basically one step above an ox cart, and ox carts rarely fail, so keep that in mind. On this earlier F-powered FJ55, of course, it has a 3-speed manual transmission, non-synchronized first gear, a 2-speed manual transfer case. It's all really basic, simple stuff. Rarely goes wrong, and when it does go wrong, it's easy and cheap to fix the oily bits. It's the metal stuff you need to look out for. Another thing to keep in mind if you're looking at FJ55s are the earlier ones, like this 1974 model, do have four-wheel drum brakes. A lot of these have been converted to disc brakes from a later model FJ, which is a completely fine upgrade to them and does help safety. But they also work really well with the drum brakes, so don't be turned off if it does have four-wheel drum brakes and you're worried about how it will operate. Toyota engineered these to work very well just the way they left the factory. So don't be turned off by the fact that drum brakes have gotten a bad rap these days. They still work perfectly fine, and in many cases work better than disc brakes, especially when off-road or going through water or mud or snow. All those things you wouldn't do with a nice FJ55 anyway. If you're expecting something to drive from Los Angeles to Lake Tahoe on a Friday after work at high speeds and comfort with air conditioning, a Land Cruiser might not be your ideal choice. They're geared low, they're heavy, they're slow. 65, 70 miles an hour is about the best you can expect from one of these rugged old trucks going on the freeway. If you're lucky, you'll get 11 or 12 miles to the gallon doing it. So the big question is, do you want an FJ55 Land Cruiser? Well, if you're like me, you do. They're just an endearing, charming truck that does everything you want a truck to do. They look great, they're rare, they have that Land Cruiser mystique, they don't break, and honestly, they're just fun to drive. Because sometimes it's nice to go slow.